to the Steps to Life Camp Meeting 2009. At these gatherings, we must ever remember that two forces are at work. We must pray that God will release the fountain of the water of life. At every meeting we attend, our prayer should ascend that at this very time, God will impart warmth and moisture to our soul. A battle unseen by human eyes is being waged. The army of the Lord is on the ground seeking to save souls. Day by day, the battle goes on. The Lord bids us, put on the whole armor of God. If we pray for the blessing in faith, we shall receive it as God has promised. Join us as we present the Steps to Life Camp Meeting 2009.
Can we reverently kneel, and we're going to spend a few moments in silent prayer, and then I will close out. Please pray for the Holy Spirit to do a work for us, brothers and sisters. Father in heaven, please have mercy upon us, your children. We've come to a point where we recognize that we have not advanced as we should have. And time has not waited for us. And tonight we pray for you to multiply our experience. We know that the only hindrance will be our choice. Empower us, assist us in making a decision now to allow you to have your way in our lives. Remove the clutter and the prejudice and all the things that strike a chord of confusion, and let us hear the voice of the Holy Spirit. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. In Matthew chapter 24, also, brothers and sisters, I was asked to share with you the site on the internet where we did this tribute. Now, it's titled A Tribute to Michael Jackson, but it's a sermon on the state of the dead, the judgment, the second coming of Christ, the first and second resurrection, and then it's an appeal. And it's you can find it under Bishop Stephen D. Lewis, Tribute to Michael Jackson. Now, don't be afraid of the word bishop. Let me just, I was afraid of it too. It scared me. And it was in the Bible. That's when I said, wow, I'm really messed up that I could see that the Bible says, he that desireth the office of a bishop desireth a good thing. I was in Chicago doing an evangelistic crusade for Philip Willis. Pastor Willis pastored the Shiloh Church there. And we rented a hall that cost $20,000 for 8 nights. And I believe that if anybody hears this message for 8 nights, they'll follow us anywhere we want to go. And we were guaranteed. They said all the big preachers come to this hall. They said once the placard goes up, or once the sign goes up, you're automatically guaranteed at least 2,000 to 3,000 visitors. And I said, well, that's worth it. And the Bible workers still did their ordinary work. Well, the first night, the sign lit, and we only had about 500 people at the meeting. Now, the Shiloh Church on the books has over 3,000 members alone, so I said, something's wrong. The second night, it was about the same. And so I went to the man and I said, I want a refund. And he said, why? I said, you guaranteed me that when the sign would go up, that I would get at least 2,000 to 3,000 visitors. He said, no, but I told you that's when the bishops come. You're an evangelist. See, I had evangelist Stephen Lewis on the sign. And I said, well, I'm a bishop. So that night, when he put that one word up there, I had over 2,000 visitors at the meeting. Amen. We baptized 467 people. Amen. Guess what? I'm a bishop. If it works, brothers and sisters, it works. And I was uncomfortable, to be honest, because I'm a fifth generation Seventh-day Adventist, and we don't use the title. So, you know, when people would say it, I would cringe. But it was amazing, the response of the world. In hotel lobbies, I say, why don't you come to our meeting? Oh, we have our own church. I say, well, here's a flyer. And they look, and they stop. Oh, you're a bishop. And I go, wow, this, you know, where I've been using evangelists all this time. Amen. Now, we don't want the world to know our secret. But so don't be afraid. I am a Seventh-day Adventist until I die. Amen. Now don't call me Reverend, because holy and reverend is his name. Amen. Amen. Matthew chapter 24. The Bible says, well, first I like to start with Matthew 23, beginning with verse 37. Heavenly Father, again, we solicit, because of our unbelief, power and presence of your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, thou that killest the prophets and stonest them which are sent unto thee, how often would I have gathered thy children together, even as a hen gathereth her chickens under her wings, and ye would not. Behold, your house is left unto you desolate. For I say unto you, ye shall not see me henceforth till ye shall say, blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. And Jesus went out and departed from the temple, and disciples came to him for to show him the buildings of the temple. And Jesus said unto them, see ye not all these things? Verily I say unto you, there shall not be left here one stone upon another that shall not be thrown down. And as he sat upon the Mount of Olives, the disciples came unto him privately, saying, tell us, when shall these things be? And what shall be the sign of thy coming and of the end of the world? And Jesus answered and said unto them, take heed that no man deceive you. For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. The disciples had their focus on the organization. And even though they had walked year after year with Christ, they really had become somewhat conditioned to believe that the system could dictate to God and not God dictate to the system. They had become more concerned with the organization than the mission. And as a result of this concern, when Jesus spoke about the temple, they worshiped that temple and they believed in that temple more than God. And they were, in a kind way, correcting Jesus. They said, Lord, look, let us show you this temple. What do you mean your house is left under you desolate? And Jesus said, listen, not one stone is going to be left upon another. And the disciples were really confused now, because now Jesus is prophesying that this great temple that they really worship. Now, if you had gone to one of them and you asked a Jew in that day, none would have said we worship the temple, but they did. They really worshiped the temple. And so Jesus told them it was going to be destroyed, and they were really confused, and they came to Christ and they said, tell us, when shall be these things and what shall be the sign of thy coming and of the end of the world? And then Jesus begins by giving them the universal sign of his coming. He gives them the sign that existed in heaven and the sign that has existed all throughout creation, ever since man was here. He first starts with that. And what is that? Deception. Let no man deceive you. Now, what man can deceive us best? Self-deception. Now, why did Christ say? Because deception is what caused the angels to be thrown out of heaven. Notice a moment in Revelation chapter 12. Revelation chapter 12, the Bible says, beginning with verse 4, speaking of the devil, it says, and his tail drew the third of the stars of heaven, and did cast them to the earth. And the dragon stood before the woman, which was ready to be delivered, for to devour her child as soon as it was born. Now, first of all, if you notice in Revelation chapter 1, in Revelation chapter 1, it tells us that the stars are angels. That the stars are angels. Notice in Revelation 1, beginning with verse 20. Revelation 1, beginning with verse 20. The Bible says, "The mystery of the seven stars, which thou sawest in my right hand, and the seven golden candlesticks." The seven stars are the angels of the seven churches. And the seven candlesticks which thou sawest are the seven churches. So he drew with his tail one third of the heavenly angels. Now, story of redemption says at one point half were on their side. And I praise God that the appeals of Jesus caused some to turn. But still, one third, that's billions and billions of angels. But notice in Isaiah chapter 9 what his tail is, or what the tail represents, in Isaiah chapter 9. In Isaiah chapter 9, the Bible tells us very clearly in verse 15, the ancient and the honorable, he is the head, and the prophet that teaches lies, he is who? The tail. So the tail would represent lies or deceit. And so here the devil deceived all these angels into believing him. Now, what caused them to believe him? The prophet of God says they sympathized with him. At first they didn't believe him, but they sympathized with him. They really got caught up in business that wasn't theirs. And they started feeling sorry for him, and then they started listening to him, and before you know it, they were looking up, and they were cast out of heaven. And Satan would love to go back to heaven. It's amazing to me when I read in Story of Redemption, and every time I read it, when the prophet of God says that Satan bid an angel, saw an angel and said, "Hey, will you come? Come." And the angel came. And he said, "Please, will you go and get Jesus for me?" And the angel went and got Christ. And Jesus comes back to talk with him, and he says, "Please, can I come back to heaven? I'll take any position. I'll take my position that you had for me now." And then it says, Jesus wept at his woe. He wept at his woe. It broke his heart because he could not be trusted to come back to heaven. Going to heaven is a trust thing. You see, brothers and sisters, the Bible says that iniquity will not rise its head again. Sin is not coming back. And when we're in heaven, we will not lose our ability to sin. We just won't do it. Our love for God, our desire and appreciation for him will place us to where we will never even consider ever doing anything contrary to his word. It's not going to be a forced thing. You see, when we look in this world, it's really interesting. I was reading today. They were talking about auctioning off some of the things that Michael Jackson owned. And I was amazed. I mean, I am really amazed. And I started begging God for the Holy Spirit. How can a man have this type of authority when God wants us to have this type of influence? This man has been performing for 40 years, and the whole world seems to be wandering after him and weeping behind him. And now they're saying that a glove that he wore, one glove that he wore that would have cost $60,000 is for a glove. They said now it will go for anywhere to $600,000. Why? Well, number one, it's rare. And on earth, the rarer things are, the more expensive they are. But Jesus is so contrary to earthly things, because the most expensive thing, or the most expensive commodity in the world, is sin. And it's everywhere, but the highest price was paid for it. As a matter of fact, Jesus bought it all. And he has a right to do with it what he wants to do with it. And what does he want to do with it? He wants to destroy it. Now, if you want to keep his property, if you want to rob him of the privilege of destroying it, guess what? You have to be destroyed with it. He doesn't want to destroy you. He wants to save you. But the enemy deceives us into believing that God has something for, I mean, that Satan has something for us and that we're missing something. Well, we're not missing anything at all. It's interesting that God asks us to do simple things. The Lord said, look, in the morning, pray for 10 minutes. In the afternoon, pray for 10 minutes. Now, we'll look at the disciples in Gethsemane and we'll say, they couldn't pray for 1 hour with Jesus. And yet, look at how hard that 10 minutes was. Look at how many people just kind of left casually. They didn't believe. And we really believe that a man stands up here and speaks. And you come and you tell that man, great job. But you don't realize that it's the oracles of God in his mercy speaking directly to your heart, giving instruction, trying to place you in a favorable position so that he can save you. And so the very first sin was deception, brothers and sisters. But then Jesus goes on and he starts talking about other signs. And notice what he says again in Matthew chapter 24. Matthew, what chapter are we talking about? 24. And you need to understand that Satan tried to deceive Jesus. And if you ever want to know why prophecy is so important, it's important because prophecy in the Word of God is the only landmarks that we have, and they will be the only landmarks that we have to know where we are in time. If you notice, when Jesus came down to the last moments of his life, Satan tried to manipulate prophecy to deceive him because he was all alone. And the only thing that he could trust in was his Father and the Word. So when you look in Zechariah chapter 11, you'll see that Zechariah chapter 11 told him how much he would be sold for. Zechariah chapter 11 told him that they would take the money that he was sold for and they would take and cast it down in the temple in the house of God. Zechariah 11 said not only would they take it and cast it down in the temple in the house of God, but then it also said that they would buy the potter's field with it. What happened when Jesus died? I mean, what happened when Jesus went to trial? When Judas became convicted that he had gone too far, he runs into the temple, and just as the prophet of God says, and by the way, for Zechariah to say over 500 years before it happens how much Jesus would be sold for, that tells me God is in charge of the economy. Amen. I don't have to worry. God is in charge. But here Judas comes, and the Bible says that Judas comes running in, and the prophet of God says that he came in, and with a screeching voice, he throws the coins down on the floor, just like Zechariah said. Now remember, Jesus sees this, and in his mind, he says, okay, I'm on course. That was the only way he knew he was on course. He didn't have any magical wand or any type of advantage than anyone else. He had to know the word of the living God. He had to study to show himself approved. So when this took place, he knew prophecies being fulfilled. I'm on course. But then somebody said, hey, let's take that money and let's put it in the treasury. Now, Jesus is here and he's listening to this conversation. And right now, he says, wait a minute. If they put that money in the treasury, then I'm off course. Because the prophecy said they would buy the potter's field with it. And then somebody said, no, we can't put the money in the treasury because it's the money of blood. And Jesus is alerted now. They say, let's buy the potter's field with it. And Jesus says, okay, I'm on course. You see, there was no one around to strengthen him. Everybody who claimed to be so close to him and so loyal, they had run out on him, brothers and sisters. Face it, the bottom line is you don't know who's going to stand when it really goes down. You better make sure you are able to stand. Because Jesus is all along loving his disciples while he's watching them look on from a distance. Then on the cross, and it's many, this is the whole message within itself. On the cross, he's hanging there. It's the final moments of his life. And what takes place? Psalm 22 says that the dogs had encompassed him. He said that he could feel pain all through his body. And then he said, they take my clothes and they cast lots for them. They take my garments and they part them and then they cast lots for them. What takes place? They're four soldiers. And now they're standing there and Jesus is on the cross and he's in excruciating pain. Everybody has run out on him. The Father had to separate himself from him. Jesus now is looking and he hears the conversation. Hey, let's split up his garments. And so they start splitting them up, but they have one piece left. The devil tries to manipulate prophecy because it's all Jesus had to keep him from doubting was his own word. And so they say, hey, let's tear it up. And somebody says, no, don't tear it up. Let's cast lots for it. When Jesus heard that, that's when he said, I'm on course. I thirst. It is finished. The devil tries to manipulate prophecy, but he cannot. Now, I want us to look at these prophecies a moment, because something here is pretty interesting. If you notice in Matthew chapter 24, notice what the word of God says. When we come down to verse 29, the Bible says, immediately after the tribulation of those days shall the sun be darkened, and the moon shall not give her light, and the stars shall fall from heaven, and the powers of the heavens shall be shaken. Right after the stars fall from heaven, notice what it says is going to take place. And then shall appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven, and then shall all the tribes of the earth mourn, and they shall see the Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven with power and what? Great glory. And he shall send his angels with a great sound of a trumpet, and they shall gather together his elect from the four winds, from one end of the heaven to the other. So this is talking about the coming of the Lord. Notice what Mark says in Mark chapter 13. In Mark chapter 13, whenever all of the disciples comment on the same thing, it's worth really paying attention to. Notice in Mark chapter 13, the Bible says in verse 24, but in those days, after that tribulation, the sun shall be darkened, and the moon shall not give her light, and the stars of heaven shall fall, and the powers that are in heaven shall be shaken, and then shall they see the Son of Man coming in the clouds with great power and glory. And then shall he send his angels to gather together his elect from the four winds, from the uttermost part of the earth to the uttermost part of the what? Of heaven. So again, Jesus said that certain things were going to transpire. These prophecies, and what they were landmarks. They were landmarks. Notice here, it first said there'd be signs, there'd be an earthquake. Then it said there'd be a sign in the sun, then a sign in the moon. And then it said there'd be signs in the stars. The stars would fall. Notice what Luke says about the same thing. Luke chapter 21. And in the Word of God, one of the things that we find in the Bible, we find, and our pioneers, they taught this, and that was the concept of repeat and enlarge. Repeat and enlarge. In Daniel chapter 2, we see the image. We have so much knowledge, but then when we get to Daniel 7, it's repeated, but now he enlarges because we see that little horn coming up. He goes further into detail, even in describing who it is. In Daniel chapter 2, it just simply says head of gold. In Daniel 7, it gives wings, and it talks about the heart of a man. It gives the leopard the four heads and the four wings. So God repeats, and he enlarges. Daniel 8, repeat and enlarge. Daniel 11, repeat and enlarge. And God doesn't change. He just simply follows the same course. Also, the literal local application of prophecy and the future worldwide application. In other words, there was a literal earth right here as we know it, and there was a flood that destroyed it. There's going to be another one, but this time it's going to be fire. It's not going to be destroyed with water. It's going to be destroyed with fire. In other words, there was a literal local Babylon, and there'll be a future worldwide Babylon. So when we look at these prophecies, I want you to notice something here. Notice in Luke chapter 21, beginning with verse 25. The Bible says in verse 25 of Luke 21, and there shall be signs in the sun and in the moon and in the stars and upon the earth distress of nations with perplexity, the sea and the waves roaring, men's hearts failing them for fear and for looking after those things which are coming on the earth, for the powers of heaven shall be shaken. And then shall they see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. Again, after this event, Jesus was to come. Now, John doesn't mention it in the book of John, but in Revelation chapter 6, he does. And notice in Revelation chapter 6 with me a moment. Revelation chapter 6. Revelation chapter 6. Notice what the Word of God says in the book of Revelation chapter 6. And remember, these prophecies were specifically given so that the people of God would have landmarks. And they would be able to see and understand that they are following the course and that God is still in charge. Amen. Do you know in the Quran there are no prophecies? You don't have any prophecies in the Quran? And do you know that the Muslims are outgrowing everybody just by birth? You see, we bought into the concept of contraceptives, abortion, and we have done, our hospitals do it. And listen, brothers and sisters, it doesn't matter what the conference thinks of me. They're my brothers. I pray for them. I feel sorry for them. I beg God that the honest in heart would somehow allow the light to hit them before it's ever too late. I'm often reminded that the one son said, no, I won't go, and another son said, yes, I would. And the one that said, yes, I would, he ended up not going all the way. And the one that said, I won't, he didn't. I'm often reminded of Paul when he was Saul. He was a strong conference man, and he killed present truth, did everything in his power. But when he met Jesus, it all changed. So I pray for them. And when I look at those hospitals, I thank God that they took Seventh-day Adventists off of them. Amen for calling it Adventist Health Systems, because it's not Seventh-day Adventists. It's not at all. And they offer abortions. And I'm not trying to beat them up, but it's a reality. Look at where we have gone as a people, brothers and sisters. Prophecy. These Muslims, they say that in 2025, they say that over 30% of America will be Muslim. They're already taking over other parts of the world just by simply birth. The Hebrews are multiplying. Look at them. If we don't do something, they're going to be more than we are. But we have bought into it. You see, we're not country living. We don't have our own farm, so we have to worry about how would I take care of those kids? And what is the fastest growing business right now? It is not wavered one bit. Organic food. And the prophet said that we were even to have our gardens, and we would take our organic food, and we would go down to the corner, and we'd have a sign up, and people would come, and they would buy it, and we'd be able to take them back and show them how we grow it and teach them the Word of God. Amen. And teach them the Word of God. We've dropped the ball, brothers and sisters. As a people. But notice here. Notice these prophecies that God gave us. Revelation chapter 6, verse 12. And we are living suspended right here between this sixth seal and the coming of the Lord. Listen to what it says. And I beheld when he had opened the sixth seal, and lo, there was a great earthquake. There's that earthquake again. And the sun became black as sackcloth of hair, and the moon became as blood, and the stars of heaven fell unto the earth, even as a fig tree casteth her untimely figs when she is shaken of a mighty wind. Now, right after these stars fall again, notice what it says. And the heaven departed as a scroll when it is rolled together, and every mountain and island were moved out of their places. And the kings of the earth, and the great men, and the rich men, and the chief captains, and the mighty men, and every bondman, and every free man, hid themselves in the dens, and in the rocks of the mountains, and said to the mountains and rocks, fall on us, and hide us from the face of him that sitteth on the throne, and from the wrath of the Lamb. For the great day of his wrath is come, and who shall be able to stand? Now, we know that we teach, or I've taught in crusades, that November 1st, 1755, there was a great Lisbon earthquake. I believe that this prophecy had already been fulfilled. Now remember, this great earthquake came just before what? 1798. Something was going to happen in 1798. So God started revealing these prophecies so that his people would understand that he was what? Soon coming. Then we know that May 19th, 1780, I promise I'll preach it, whoever's out there. And I want you to teach your next door neighbor, amen? I know you're excited about it. I know you know it, but go to your next door neighbor and teach him this thing, amen? Amen. Notice what it says. We know that that day the sun went black, and that night the moon turned red as blood. And these were big events. Now, this one here, there were three earthquakes that day, one at 9, one at 10, and one at 12. And it was interesting when you study it, because at 9, people became afraid. At 10, people really got scared. And by 12 o'clock, they had run to the church to pray. And do you know where thousands died? In church. In church. God is not the author of fear. You see, when you become afraid when you hear these messages, it's the Lord telling you you're not on his side. When you get excited and say, my redemption draws nigh, that's where we are to be. But if we're not resting in Christ, if we have not understood what it means to rest in Christ and believe that he will keep us from falling and believe that he can save us, and not a deceptive belief, because if you're living in known sin, you're not resting in Christ. You are of your father, the devil. The young people learned this morning that in Christ there's no sin, period. In him, that's how we know. In him is no sin, period. Because it's the mind of Christ literally living through you. It's the faith of Jesus. I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live. Not I that liveth, but Christ lives in me. And the life that I now live is by the faith of. It's literally Christ's faith activated in my life. I don't have the faith to believe that God is going to open up a body of water for me to walk across it. That's contrary to everything my humanity knows. But he has the faith, and he's willing to activate that faith in our lives. He's willing to give us that experience. But you will never, as we talked this morning, you will never get that experience, Samuel, unless you go to God and you plead for it and you pray for it. And guess what? When you read this book, one thing you're going to see is the Holy Spirit is not limited to ages. The Holy Spirit will fill you and call you and cause you to shine for God at that age. And he's looking for you to do it. Why? Because we need an example. We need a representative of God. Who shall be able to stand? And so here they ran to the church and they died. Do you know that preachers started preaching that this was a sign of the coming of the Lord? They attributed this to prophecy. They believed that this was prophecy. And then, brothers and sisters, there was a preacher alive and preached the prophecy of this earthquake when 1780 came. So when 1780 comes, and all of a sudden it's noontime and the sun just goes black, like a light bulb that goes out. Cattle start heading back to barns. People become afraid. And that night, red as blood, it was as though you could touch it, as though it would drip the moon. The preachers were preaching. Churches were full. They said, this is a sign of the coming of the Lord. And the Lord had given us these signs specifically for a reason. Then in 1833, when these stars fell, brothers and sisters, and at the same time, what happened? They started preaching prophecies all over the world. William Miller started preaching. And they started preaching that the Lord was coming. And when these stars fell, they looked at Matthew 24, they looked at Mark 13, they looked at Luke 21, they looked at Revelation 6, and they said, Jesus is coming. He has to come. Why? Because the prophecy said that after these stars would fall, Jesus would come. But what happened? What happened? 1844 comes. 1844 comes, and Jesus doesn't come. He doesn't come. But he wanted to come right after this. Because Revelation 7 says that right after these stars fell, Revelation 6 says that after these stars fell, the heavens rolled back like a scroll. Jesus wanted to come. But what happened? His people weren't ready. He saw that his people weren't ready. Early writing says that Jesus was ready to stand up and close it out. Whew. That's not for effects. That's my own, you know. Any preacher will tell you that when he's standing up talking, it's a miracle going on, because he's hearing and making decisions as he's speaking. And the same thing that you're being convicted on, I just said, Lord, thank you for lengthening probation. None of us would have been in heaven. None of us. But what happened? The prophet of God says, and she says it, I don't believe the exact year, but it's just shortly, I believe it was either 1849 or 1850, 51, somewhere in there, she says she gives this testimony in early writings where Jesus was about to stand up. The angel had already been given the command to let loose. The plagues were about to be poured out. And Jesus stood up and she says that he glanced and he noticed that his people, the number wasn't made up. And he cried, my blood. And she says a light went from the Father to an angel, and the angel was dispatched, and the angel started crying, hold the winds of strife, hold the winds of strife. And these other angels, they were just about ready to let him go, and they grabbed it. Probation was extended, brothers and sisters. It was extended. Now, when we look, brothers and sisters, when we look in Ezekiel, notice in Ezekiel 9, now, this is very important that you understand these next few moments, brothers and sisters. It's very, very important that you understand these next few moments. Now, we know what was taking place. In Ezekiel chapter 8, here's the setting. Literal local application. This was really going on. God's people. Remember, Ezekiel wasn't preaching to the heathens. He was preaching to God's people. You know how many years I kept applying scripture to the world when God was talking about his own people? I used to tell the people that the worldly ministers were going to tell their people, don't worry, he's a fanatic. But it's not the world telling people I'm a fanatic. As a matter of fact, I have first day ministers that call me all the time. I've had them sit down and cry. I had one, a guy by the name of Gardner Taylor. He's supposed to be what they call the dean of black preachers. I mean, he's so popular. I called his hotel room. We're in the same hotel down at an evangelism council, and I called him. They brought this first day guy to preach, and it was amazing how he got up and preached, because he got up and he said, you know, I read the book Education and started a Christian school. I read the book Stewardship by your prophet. Now, you have all these ministers sitting out here. And he said, you guys don't believe your prophet. How do I know? Because in New York, you don't have a school like mine. We have over $10 million in reserve cash following your book Stewardship. Now, they handle tithe differently. And let me just say this, too. Nobody makes me give commercials. We need to start giving more, brothers and sisters. And we need to start giving offering. You see, when you send your tithe to ministries like this, it's a blessing, but it's limited. We can't spend tithe any type of way we would like to. And often, the offering suffers. We are living in a day and hour where the world is telling you that the cash and the money is being depleted, and nobody's going to have any. If there was ever a time that we need to start supporting the truth with our finances, I mean, literally downsizing and asking God, first of all, for forgiveness for how we have squandered it. You see, first of all, let me just say this. When we look at the Lord, when we give our hearts to God, all of it is God's. 100%. Now, if you went and you bought a car and your car note was $300 and you went to the bank at the end of the month, and you gave that $300 to the banker, and you were headed back out to your car, and the banker came back, and he ran outside, and he said to you, listen, hold it. I want to give you $270 back. You say, what? Say, no, all I'm going to keep is 30 of it. And you go on. You would rejoice. You would be so excited that he gave you all this money back. You might even look at him and tip him. But when it comes to God, we give him as little as possible. It's because we don't really love him. It's because we don't really believe. We're constantly trying to hold something back. It is time to support God's work. You need to flood your money and bless God. You have a ministry here. You have a church where you can go to. And still, we find ourselves, as the prophet of God says, she says, when they appoint meetings, Satan is on the grounds to control the money. And she says that she saw that Satan will place within the hearts of those that will give a grudging disposition that they'll give sparingly. Brothers and sisters, I promise you'll never go broke giving to God. Amen. When it comes time to give your offering here, look at what you decided to give and times it by 10, and I guarantee God will bless you to be able to do it. It's serious. It's time to get. God's house should not be suffering. We should have plenty to do the work of the Lord. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray for this ministry. I pray that you would please pour out your rich blessings so that they could do a greater work, so their influence can be felt even broader, so that more workers can be sent forth to do the work that we've heard in these mission reports. We're grateful that you take care of this ministry. And I've never had this conversation, but I know how you have blessed us. And I know that you do, but I also know that we could do more if your people would give and be more free and know that they are not giving to us, but giving to your work. Please bless it in Jesus' name. Amen. So here, brothers and sisters, this is what was happening in Ezekiel chapter 8. The church was in sin. And God sent an angel, and he grabbed Ezekiel by the lock of his hair, and he suspended him between the earth and between heaven. And he said, look, Ezekiel, let me show you the people of God the way I see them. And Ezekiel was a true Christian. He didn't want to see sin. He tried to turn. And the Lord said, no, look further. And he saw all these abominations and all this filthiness, and his heart was broken. And he said, no, look further. And he kept telling him to look further. And finally, notice what he saw. Notice what he saw in verse 16. And he brought me into the inner court of the Lord's house. And behold, at the door of the temple of the Lord, between the porch and the altar, were about 25 men. And with their backs toward the temple of the Lord, and their faces toward the east, and they worshiped the sun toward the east. So he saw where God's people had started cooperating with sun worship. Now, brothers and sisters, that's when he said, it's time for the inkhorn angel to do his work. Now, if you don't believe that our people have been deceived and they have bought into this ecumenical movement, it's time to open your eyes. Now, I don't study what the church is doing. I'm too busy working myself. But I do know when we have a Catholic cardinal open our general conference session with prayer, something's wrong. I do realize when the undersecretary of the United Nations comes and gives a speech, because see, we plan these programs thoroughly. You speak of organization? Oh, they plan who's going to get a minute at that mic. And for that undersecretary to stand up and tell us that we need to get rid of artificial constructs. An artificial construct is something that you have constructed in your mind as deeply important, or something that you may have as an axiom in your life, non-negotiable. But it's not really that important, like the Sabbath. It's an artificial construct. It doesn't matter what day you worship God on. And then he said in the most eloquent words, thank you for cooperating with us. And then he turned around and said, and if you don't, we know how to deal with people who don't cooperate. And all of the constituents gave him a standing ovation. A standing ovation. At the last general conference session, why during the parade of nations did the Vatican have a flag? Italy was there. Why did the Vatican have a flag? Is this the abomination of desolation? Are we seeing? God is trying to show us, brothers and sisters. But some of us, we still won't pray. We still won't agonize with God. We still won't get our lives in order so that the Holy Spirit can use us to be effective for God. And you need to know that this message, when it goes forth, it's going forth by Seventh-day Adventists. The faithful ones who are really praying and they're really studying, or according to Ezekiel 9, they're crying and sighing for the abominations that be done in the land. Not gossiping, not tearing down. I read today that this boy, I keep calling him a boy because Michael Jackson was a little boy when I was a little boy. They said that he, this week, that in 24 countries, they have downloaded his music all over these countries. They can't even handle the downloads. And he is making, has made millions, over $100 million this week. And guess what song is selling? Man in the Mirror. So I said, what is Man in the Mirror? I didn't know what Man in the Mirror was because I don't listen to him. went on the internet, book lyrics, Man in the Mirror. Do you know what Man in the Mirror says? Who are you fooling? If you want change, you need to look in the mirror at yourself and change yourself and stop dealing with other people. I said, Lord, are the rocks crying out? Brothers and sisters, we have to start looking inside. We have to make sure that we are on the path that God has placed us on. We don't have time to come off the wall and get caught up in all these surface issues. We must start pointing and understanding that I want to be a candidate. I want to give the loud cry. But some of you are disqualified. What would you preach if you don't know the message? How can he use you if you don't know the message? I mean, know it, brothers and sisters, where the Holy Spirit lifts you as he lifted Philip. Do you believe the Bible? Picks him up and an angel takes him to a whole nother city to preach the word of God. The Lord is going to distribute us everywhere as needed to give this final cry. And it's going to swell. And guess what? It's going to be for the first time since heaven. It's going to be a duplication of what took place in heaven. Jesus himself preached in heaven and Lucifer preached in heaven. One third of the angels follow Lucifer while the rest follow Jesus. We are going to be completely trusted and filled with the power of the Holy Spirit. Satan is going to be personating Christ. Satan himself is going to be preaching, and through the power of the Holy Ghost with the same authority that Christ preached with in heaven, we're going to be preaching. Converts are coming in who God can't trust with us right now. You see, some of us are really confused. You see, you start wondering, well, Pastor Grossball's on television. How many people are coming in? God is not concerned with who's coming in. The Bible says, and this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness, not so they'll come in. For a witness. Only 8 people got on board that ark. Only 8. 8, brothers and sisters. God is not caught up in numbers, but millions are coming out of first day churches and from all around who God cannot trust with us. You know why? Because many of us have never had a real conversion experience, and we will push down their throat our works, and we will tell them that the faith that they had, it was not real. And so the Lord is literally preserving certain people right there in the world. They drive by this church and other Seventh-day Adventist churches and never see the signs. An angel is dispatched to stand out there and just blind them so they don't see it. Do you realize, brothers and sisters, that if you don't know the message, the Lord cannot give it to you in that time? You have to start studying. Stop wasting time. If you don't have a schedule for your time every day, you're not going to make it. Our time belongs to God. Of no other gift is he given will we have to give a more strict account than that of our time. And I'm telling you, if you don't have a written schedule, I give my church schedules all the time. Copy that schedule. And every day, look at what you have to do, and then look at the free time and give God your time. It is a must. If you don't, you're not going to be prepared, brothers and sisters. It's going to overwhelm you when it breaks upon the world as an overwhelming surprise. You're not going to be ready. This form of godliness, but denying the power thereof, all are going to be exposed for who they really are. If you have not begun and developed an ear where you hear the Holy Spirit saying, this is the way, walk ye in it. Not trusting man. Brother Feliciano, the more you run to man for your solutions, the more you disappoint God. The prophet of God said, it insults God how many of us never come to him. We want to run to man rather than getting on our knees, cleaning up our lives. You come to a pastor for counseling, first do your own examination. You know, Pastor or Brother Jackson gives those 8 laws of health. I say New Start. I think he says God's plan. And then when he gives it, if you're sick, he says the way to diagnose yourself is first check to see whether you're following those 8 things. If your home is in trouble, or if you're in trouble, check to see whether or not, am I praying, am I studying, am I surrendered to God? Then all things work together for the good. But you want God to work a miracle when you won't do what he has asked you to do. Some of us don't have family worship. Simple things. Why is the Lord talking about family worship? And we're the ones that believe. We throw bricks at the conference. And some of them get up and worship every day. George Bush every morning started his day with worship. And people talk about him and what a terrible person he was. Pharaoh, God said, Moses, go meet him down there at the Nile. What was he doing down there? He had morning devotion. And some of you don't have morning devotion. I was in India, traffic jam. And if you've ever been to India, whoa, the way they drive, it's amazing. And I said, what's going on? It was a big old ugly cow. Walked out in the middle of the street and just stopped. And I said, nobody's blowing. Nobody's out there trying to move the cow. You mean you guys are just going to wait until that cow decides to move? Oh, yes, because that cow is sacred. And for those who believe that that cow is sacred, they will kill you for bothering that cow. So they wait. And I started laughing for a minute. And the preacher that was with me started laughing for a minute. And then the Holy Spirit said, you know, isn't it interesting that you're laughing? But you don't respect me like that. You know the true God, and you don't reverence me the way they're reverencing that cow. And in the judgment, their loyalty to a cow is going to come up against you who had access to the true God of heaven. It is no excuse for you not to have a personal relationship with God. There's no excuse for you not to be able to go to him and know that he's going to answer your prayer. It's no excuse, brothers and sisters. And here we are now. We have squandered all this time, and the prophet of God, praise God, she says we can redeem the time. How? By not wasting any more. Get a schedule. Every day, look at that schedule. At night, look at that schedule and try to give God as much time as you possibly can, and he will prepare you for the crisis, or he will trust you to die. You have to be trusted to die because you have to die in Christ. I remember years ago, I didn't never met Marshall Grossball, but I always admired what they did. As a matter of fact, I started preaching on gossip because he sent a tape to me called Words. In 1992, he did a sermon called Words. And I used to get that tape of the month. And when I looked at that thing, I said, wow, words. Words. What we talk about. We are preachers, and the prophet of God says we must be careful not to have our tongues sanctified to the devil. Brothers and sisters, we must start studying. We must start praying, and we must ask God to teach us how to be quiet. I talk too much. That's why I run from people. I talk too much. Just go on. And a clown? Oh, natural. Just a natural. But it's not God. It's not God. And so you have to know your limits. You have to know your bounds. You have to know where you have to be. Jesus understood. He didn't go amongst men. Why? Not because he felt better, because he knew what was in man, and he was a man. And if he just relaxed, he knew that he would be off guard. We're in a crisis, brothers and sisters. We are at war. We're at war. So here God says, go and place a seal. Go place a seal upon the foreheads of the men that cry and that sigh. In other words, when you see people sinning, it breaks your heart. Not because, oh, look at them, but because there's a Savior who wants to save them, and you recognize he's going to be heartbroken. It's going to break Jesus' heart to destroy the wicked. It's going to break his heart. He wrote their names on the palms of his hands. He's not going to strike them from his hands. The book, yes. It's going to break his heart if you are lost. And he has given you every opportunity and even more to be saved. And yet, we refuse. But when you are filled with the Spirit, you will find yourself weeping and crying because there's so many people trapped in sin. You will find yourself losing your comforts to cause others to feel comfortable so they can know your God. You will constantly pray and ask God, how can I win another one? How can I reach somebody else? What more can I do for you, Lord? Please, I just want, because it's Christ filling or letting you feel his burden through you. It's literally him. The patience of the saints. They keep the commandments and they have the faith of Jesus, his faith. And so here you are being sealed because, or settling into the truth both spiritually and intellectually, you're being sealed by God because you have surrendered to God, and he can trust you now with his character to the point where he calls it the righteousness of the saints. It's not even mine anymore. It's yours because you're sealed, and I can trust you with it. This is the experience he wants us to have. And so all of a sudden, we see Ezekiel chapter 9 being interrupted. Because the destroying angels were to go forth and they were to destroy everybody. Now I know the shepherd's rods, they come and they teach that this is literal and that God is coming back and angels are going to really or come in and they're really going to kill people in the church or something like that. Well, if it's literal, then we don't have to worry. You know why? Because this was in Jerusalem. So if it's literal, we're not in Jerusalem. Amen. And you can't have it both ways. You know, you have the feast day people. You know, they want to keep the feast, but they're not slaying lambs. They're not killing animals. They just want to kind of keep them both. But the feast never interlapped. In other words, it was never the Passover and the Day of Atonement at the same time. And we're in the Day of Atonement right now, the anti-typical Day of Atonement. So when that's over, then you're going to start keeping the other ones. Brothers and sisters, people are looking for something because they don't have the Holy Spirit. But if they plead and they pray and they become compassionate and desirous to be filled with the Spirit, God will redirect those thoughts and he will show them the simple things. Amen. Now notice here, Ezekiel 9 was held up. Notice what it says here. Now remember, it was possible for someone to have been alive. Say if they were about 10 years old here when this took place. Then they would be about 99 or 98, somewhere close to 100 in 1844. So somebody could have literally witnessed all these events. God gave these events for what? For a reason. Now, God lengthened probation at 1844. And what did the Bible say? Time would be no more. What does that mean? That meant after this point, there was no prophecy that we could hold on to where we could gauge how soon the coming of the Lord was going to be. And so what did God do? The Bible said that God has never left his people without a prophet, without prophecy. So what did God do? Notice what it says on your paper. In order of sequence, I want you to see something. Now, first of all, remember what we said before you look at your paper. These prophecies, they don't have a literal application for us. This was supposed to wake up the people in our pioneers' day so that they will be ready for the coming of the Lord. Now these prophecies, they only have a spiritual or a symbolic meaning to us. Earthquake, shaking, huh? Sun going out, light of Jesus leaving the church, moon turning red as blood, blood of Jesus available but kind of out of our reach, stars falling, bright light, stars who once stood for their brilliancy now going out everywhere. So let's look at this as symbols. But the Lord comes back and he doesn't leave his people without a witness. Now notice what I found the other day when I was studying, and I've read this many times. Notice what it says on your paper. We are living in the end of time. The fast fulfilling signs of the times declare that the coming of Christ is near at hand. The days in which we live are solemn and important. The Spirit of God is gradually but surely being withdrawn from the earth. Plagues and judgments are already falling upon the despisers of the grace of God. The calamities by land and sea, the unsettled state of society, the alarms of war are portentous. They forecast approaching events of the greatest magnitude. The agencies of evil are combining their forces and consolidating. They are strengthening for the last great crisis. Great changes are soon to take place in our world, and the final movements would be rapid ones. And then she describes the condition of the world. She says, bold robberies are a frequent occurrence. Strikes are common. Thefts and murders are committed on every hand. Men possessed of demons are taking the lives of men, women, and little children. Men have become infatuated with vice, and every species of evil prevails. So she's telling us what the world was going to be like, and then all of a sudden, she says, I'm going to give you your sun turning black, or your moon turning black red, or your stars. I'm going to give you a pointed prophecy. And notice what she says. She says, on one occasion, when in New York City I was in the night season, called upon to behold buildings rising story after story toward heaven. These buildings were warranted to be fireproof, and they were erected to glorify the owners and builders. Higher and still higher these buildings rose, and in them the most costly material was used. Those to whom these buildings belonged were not asking themselves, How can we best glorify God? The Lord was not in their thoughts. I thought, oh, that those who are thus investing their means could see their course as God sees it. They are piling up magnificent buildings, but how foolish in the sight of the ruler of the universe is their planning and devising. They are not studying with all their powers of heart and mind how they may glorify God. They have lost sight of this, the first duty of man. As these lofty buildings went up, the owners rejoiced with ambitious pride that they had money to use in gratifying self and provoking the envy of their neighbors. Much of the money that they thus invested had been obtained through exaction, through grinding down the poor. They forgot that in heaven an account of every business transaction is kept. Every unjust deal, every fraudulent act is there recorded. The time is coming when in their fraud and insolence, men will reach a point that the Lord will not permit them to pass. And they will learn that there is a limit to the forbearance of Jehovah. The scene that next passed before me was an alarm of fire. Men looked at the lofty and supposedly fireproof buildings and said they are perfectly safe. But these buildings were consumed as if made of pitch. The fire engines could do nothing to stay the destruction. The firemen were unable to operate the engines. This is a clear depiction of 9/11. A clear depiction. Buildings, too, going higher and higher. The day before 9/11, there was a special on the History Channel or the Discovery, one of these different channels, talking about how they erected these buildings. The man said, and they were saying, well, how did it withstand the 1993, I believe it was, when they first tried to bring them down? And he started talking about the way we erected it. They are fireproof. Nothing can bring these down. We used the most costly material, and we were ready for this. Brothers and sisters, some say that they put bombs, and it was an implosion because the way the building fell. No, the prophet of God said that it was coming down. Angels touched that building, brothers and sisters. That was our modern day sign. God said, look, I'm coming. Guess what? Do you want to know how they reacted in November 1755? Do you want to know how they responded in 1780? You want to know how they responded in 1833? We saw with our own eyes how they responded after 9/11. All of a sudden, sports was no longer important. Now, I've been preaching what the prophet says. She says in Review and Herald, Satan invented sports. And the purpose is to take the minds of God's people where they won't think of God. But now everybody agreed. No baseball games, no football games, all these night show talk, laugh shows, they stopped. People only want to talk about God. My neighbors, all of a sudden they were interested. When I first moved into my neighborhood and they invited us over for these little housewarming parties and I went by and they would offer me beer and I said, no, I don't drink, I'm a minister. Oh, well, my pastor's cool. You see, me and my pastor are buddies. He knows he can come to my house and have a beer. And no one's going to know. And I said, well, I don't drink. You know, but you go ahead and drink. I'm not telling you. I don't drink. And so we were killjoys. So we weren't invited. You know what I would see? They would have little neighborhood parties, and they still do. But when they would walk by my house, I mean, adults, one would come out and kind of look to see if we're outside. And then he'd say, come. And they'd take their wine bottles and their beer, whatever they had, and they'd run by my house. And I'd sit on the balcony looking, and I'd say, wow, this is amazing. And when they get so far, I speak to them, hey, how you doing? You know, and they, oh, you know. But after 9/11, oh, no, we have a bishop in the neighborhood. Come and pray in our home. Whole church on the cul-de-sac. Everybody, they would drive by and wave. Everybody was afraid, brothers and sisters. They became solemn, serious about God. This is the way they responded this, on all these things. When those animals got on board that ark, everybody was interested. And listen, remember, man lived to be 900 years old. So they were not cavemen. They, 900 years, what would your computer skills be like? I look at the pastor, and I call him the pastor over the media, Brother Burt, godly man. Great brother. Pray for him and his wife all the time. If he had 900 years, what would he develop in that media room? And it's a ministry. It's a viable ministry. What would he, 900 years, can you imagine what type of camera systems they had? Their CNN of their day, broadcasting these animals coming together on the ark. Everybody was frightened. They were scared, just like here. But when nothing happened, they went back to business as usual. Because fear is not going to get you to be loyal to God. But when that angel, prophet of God says that angel swirled around in the sky, dropped down, grabbed hold of that big massive door, and shut it, everybody was afraid. Quiet. Why didn't God cause the rain to start right then? Because people would have said, Lord, if you would have only given me a few more days, I was going to get on board. So what did he do? He allowed that emotion to wear off. First day, everybody was praying, oh God. Second day, praying, oh God. Wednesday night prayer meeting, all the churches were filled, just like all the churches were filled here and all the churches were filled after 9/11. But then when nothing happened, somebody cracked a little joke. Before you know it, by Thursday, they were laughing, and Noah was a wild fanatic. All the preachers preached on it that Sabbath, and while they were planning to do whatever they do sunset Saturday, out of nowhere on that eighth day, clouds, dark, hellish clouds, came together, and with a combustion that man had never ever experienced, from the top and from the bottom, water came from everywhere, and it was too late. Oh, yes, then they wanted God. They cried for Noah. And listen, brothers and sisters, some of you are so trapped when it comes to your siblings and your children and your parents who don't want your God. And you spend time and money on them when they don't want your God. But your true family, the people of God, who is my brother? Who is my sister? Who is my mother? They that do the will of my Father. Your true family lacks while you're feeding. And some of you have wills and you'll die and you'll leave unconverted children your money. Listen, brothers and sisters. When Noah got on board the ark, he had family members outside. The Bible said his father had more children. So he had sisters. Possibly his mother was alive, screaming. But he had to trust in God. His name, Noah, means rest. Resting in Christ, brothers and sisters. He was resting in confidence with God. Well, guess what? The same way they acted that day, 9/11, it was the same thing. Remember when they filled the Yankee Stadium? And all the different religions came across the stage and they all prayed or said whatever they wanted to say. All the major religions were there. It was about 4 hours. Everybody watched it all over the world. Do you remember the Seventh Day Adventists that got up? Anybody remember? God would not let one get up. He would not let the world be deceived. There's no way he was going to let somebody get up and say that they were the Seventh-day Adventists and they represented his remnant while all this apostasy is going on. God is looking for Peter, James, John to get in that upper room. You see, you get caught up looking for the second coming. Jesus said, I'm coming back. You get in that room and pray for the Holy Ghost. Why stand you here gazing? Get in that room and wait for the promise. Wait for the promise. Well, brothers and sisters, notice what the next statement says. Look at this final statement. There are not many. Now remember, this is after 9/11. There are not many, even among educators and statesmen, who comprehend the causes that underlie the present state of society. This is after 9/11. Those who hold the reins of government are not able to solve the problem of moral corruption, poverty, pauperism, and increasing crime. They are struggling in vain to do what? Place business, what? Operations on a more secure. What are they doing right now? The economy's coming back. Obama's telling everybody it's going to be good. It's not coming back, brothers and sisters. It's not coming back. God did not leave us without a witness in details. He's saying, listen, you must know. You have to believe in the prophet. She didn't write this for her day, brothers and sisters. It was for us. And just like because right after 9/11, nothing happened right away, people became relaxed again. And now we see the economy is gone. It's not coming back. I'm telling you, brothers and sisters. Everybody is crying for the government to support them. Take care of us. Take care of us. You're responsible for us. They're going to take care of us. But at what cost? At what cost? Health care. At what cost? Save your home. At what cost? What did she say? She said the time would come where those who own real estate, it would come up and crush them. Prophecy. Our time. This little old lady, this dear, precious prophetess that God gave us, is trying to tell us through the Holy Spirit that we should have our houses in order. There is no time to pretend that you have an experience that you don't really have. You know what goes on when no one else is looking but God. You know how interested you really are in His Word. And it's okay, because the flesh, that woman, remember that woman and that husband? That husband's alive. If you would ask God, He promises He won't cast you out. But some of us won't even consistently ask. We won't seek Him with all our hearts. We're too busy being occupied with the cares of these world, of this world. He has brought this camp meeting for you, not to be like a regular camp meeting. You cannot allow your experience. It amazes me how we walk out of this sanctuary and we're not praying. And we're not saying, listen, let me tell you what God did for me. We just start casually talking. The seed drops and it doesn't take root. We're so casual. We should be able to have a good time praying together, talking about the things of God, going home and spending time in prayer, pleading with God, saying, Lord, wait a minute. Out of all the people in this world, you trusted me tonight with this message. Out of all the people, me, you've blessed me to be at these meetings. Please help me, Lord, lest I perish. Not trying to be all articulate, and sometimes just lay before God and say help and wait on His voice and linger. The prophet of God said when she was young, when she was 15 years old, she said she would wait till her twin sister went to sleep and get out of the bed, and she would plead with God and agonize with Him and say, Lord, I'm not going to go to bed until you bless me. And she said sometimes the sun would come up, but the Lord blessed her because she prevailed in prayer. You have to search. You have to ask God. But the promise is that you'll receive it, and it's worth asking. It's worth it. This world cannot continue to go on, brothers and sisters. It can't. It cannot. Are you ready for Jesus to come? Have you really, really embraced eternal life? Because the Bible says this is life eternal, that you'll know Jesus. Do you really know Him? Then that's even worse if you know Him and you can continue to live the way you're living. I promise that He wants to have an intimate, personal relationship with you. The younger you are, the easier it will be, because you don't have to fight through all the different things that you have conditioned yourself to believe. Your mind is impressionable. If you surrender to God at a young age and plead with God, the man that can get up and give a testimony about how he smoked and drank and ran in the world, he just shows you it doesn't take any effort to be a fool. But the man that says, I've never gone that route, I've never, and filled with the Holy Spirit, John the Baptist was a young man preaching and doing ministry, real ministry, before Jesus came on the scene. But he knew Jesus. And when he looked up, he saw Him. And he said, this is the Lamb of God. There He is. That's Him. That's Him. God wants you to know Him like that. He wants all of us to know Him like that. He wants us to be prepared. Angels weep every day. They cry. They look at us. And they say, don't they want to come home? Don't they want to come home? If you look at what the enemy's offering you, even on a human level, you have to admit it's temporal. It's temporary. He's not even trying to make you believe it's going to last forever. I began asking two questions. Where are you? Where are you? Adam, but not Adam, you. Where are you? And then the second question, what doest thou here? Why are you at this camp meeting? And I want to end with two questions. The first one, Ezekiel 18. Why? Why will you die, O house of Israel? I have no pleasure at all in the death of the wicked. The Lord says, why? Why will you die? You write it down and you go ask. Look at your life and ask, why am I going to die? The Lord says, I have no pleasure at all. At all. Why? Why will you die? Second question, what? What? Isaiah 5. What more could I have done to my vineyard? What more could God have done for you? And these are very pertinent questions, brothers and sisters. What are you going to give eternal life up for? I don't care about streets of gold, mansions, trees that bow down. I'll enjoy it. But to live without being able to talk to Jesus. When the world turns their back on you, when nobody else understands, when everybody else is trying to figure it out, and the Lord is saying, come, son, come. Come here. Let me hold you. It's going to be all right. I called you. I'm going to keep you. Come on. When the Lord talks to you and he walks with you and you build that relationship over years and then you spit in his face and he keeps following you. And then when you're ready, you turn. He says, come. Come on. Come, come on. Never mentions a spit. And he says, I want to give you my victory. That's how you're supposed to act, Stephen, when you walk in the flesh. That's what you'll do to me every time. You will kill me. That husband hates me. He hates me. Jesus really has a personal interest in seeing you in heaven. He created you for two reasons. Number one, for his pleasure and for his joy, to fellowship with us. We were to fellowship with him in a way that no one else, no other created being. And number two, for education. He was going to use us to educate the other worlds. He still has that desire. He literally wants to save you. He wants to save you. Why will you die, O house of Israel? What more could I have done to my vineyard? What more could God have done? Tonight, there is more available, more power available. Satan has limited power, and in this room is unlimited power. If you'll make a choice, a serious choice, would you bow your heads and close your eyes? A choice tonight. Not a promise, because you can't keep promises. He can. But make a decision tonight. Lord, I give you my heart. I was so glad tonight when I was asked to pray that I could ask God to reordain me tonight. You see, everything else that is made new has to be waited on, but you can get a new heart right now, and you can ask an hour from now, he'll give you a new one again. He wants to give you a new heart. A change is wrought which man can never accomplish for himself. It is a supernatural work, bringing a supernatural element into human nature. The Holy Spirit wants desperately right now to give you a new experience. Old things have passed away. Ask God. The prophet of God says the prayer that we should pray is, Lord, I believe that thou hast given thy life for mine. And if you have placed such a value on my life as to give your life for mine, I will respond. I give my life with all its possibilities and all its weaknesses into thy keeping. Lord, I believe, help thou mine unbelief. Just ask him tonight, Lord, help me, lest I perish. Please help me. Help me. And keep me, Lord. Our Heavenly Father, I thank you for your love and for your mercy. And I thank you for Jesus Christ and the sacrifice that he has made for me and for my brothers and sisters. Please, in this final hour of Earth's history, don't allow me to hinder you from performing your works in my life. Help me to cooperate. Teach me how to surrender. Teach my brothers and sisters how to surrender. May this camp meeting be one of such a high and exalted nature that even those who will come for the weekend will feel the presence of the living God and marvel that we have been in your presence and we were not consumed. Thank you so much, Lord. In the name of Jesus, we believe. Help thou our unbelief. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Brothers and sisters, stern battles with self. When you feel that you are headed in a direction that you know is not God, stop and pray. Stop and pray. Don't try to wait till you get home. Stop and pray. Cut conversations up. Let people say whatever they want to say. You know in Ezekiel 14 where it says Noah, Daniel, and Job says none of these men be able to save you. You know, I looked up their names and I looked up the order. Noah meaning rest. Daniel meaning God is my judge. And Job meaning hated. If we're resting in Christ and all we care about is God being our judge, you're not going to please man. You want to find something wrong with me? It's not hard to do. You want to find something wrong with steps of life? It's not hard to do. Satan will even distort the truth and make you believe a lie. Did you know that's what happens? Strong delusions. But brothers and sisters, live for God. Live for God. God is my judge. It doesn't matter what people say. And you know what? Young people, the greatest education you can get is to learn the will of God for your life. There's no greater education than to learn the will of God for your individual life. And the greatest accomplishment that you can ever achieve is to allow God to fulfill that will in you. It doesn't matter whether you'll get a plaque or accolades from man. People say to me, oh, you're a great evangelist. You baptized thousands. Do you know I have not run one successful evangelistic crusade? In the sight of man, every one of them, you knocked it out the park. But at the end of the meeting, when I go get on my knees and I go and examine and say, did I do exactly what you told me to do? And the Lord says, no, I asked you to fast this day. Somebody came and said, let me take you to lunch. What would have happened if I would have cooperated with everything? Success is whether or not you have done what God has asked you to do, not whether or not you baptized 400 people. That doesn't matter. Did you do what God asked you to do? Learn what God's will is for your life and allow the Holy Spirit to perform that will. And he desires to do it, brothers and sisters. I promise in our day, Jesus is going to come. He's going to come. I don't know if I'll be alive or not. I hope he could trust me to die if that's what he sees. But I want to be in Christ one way or another. I want to be in Christ if I have to die. I want to remain in Christ if I'm alive. But I don't ever want to experience wanting to talk to Jesus and not being able to. He's been such dear friend, a sweet friend, and I'm not going to sell him out. He's been a good friend, the only friend I mean a real friend, please, I invite you to get to know him. Get to know him.